Kia ora and welcome to the front row. I'm Jack Tame, and with me today are former All Black and Manu Samoa halfback Ofisa Tonu'u and TVNZ's Paul Moor. Today we're going to look ahead to the do-or-die clash between the All Blacks and Ireland, the incredible run from Japan and two other exciting-looking quarterfinals, and we'll hear from Kimberly Downs and Scotty Stevenson in Tokyo shortly. We'll get to the All Blacks soon, but how good was that Japan win over Scotland? What an atmosphere. I think before we dig into it, it's worth hearing from coach Jamie Joseph after the Japan win. He summed it up nicely when he talked about what it means to the country and the respect his team have earned with their historic campaign.
We call it noise, well, I call it noise, which is basically everything from, you know, walking into a hotel and having hundreds to thousands of people clapping, you walking through Tokyo Station and having 50 people, you know, parting their ways like you're royalty, and it's a little bit different.
And you know what, guys? They deserve it, don't they? Japan have been a standout at this competition.
Absolutely, and that makes the beginning of the tournament, doesn't it? Remember last time when England got knocked out early? We were all quite happy that England got knocked out early, but the tournament's felt a little bit flat for a bit. But when you've got your hosts playing really well and winning, especially a team that wasn't expected to do this well, it's great.
It casts my mind back to 91 when the Samoa team first made their quarterfinals. And they still remember to today, and hoping that the next team will go there. And but you know, the parades that went back to the islands, and the thanks, and how big it boosted up rugby in the Pacific was huge.
Well, you know, what can we put it down to? I know obviously that the coaching staff in Japan have had a fair bit of success and been credited with a lot of the Cherry Blossoms run so far. But the Brave Blossoms run so far? What do you think, Paul?
That's a bit of everything. I think they've got good players and they've got good coaching and they've had a good plan for a while, haven't they? They knew they were hosting the World Cup and they knew they had to do well at it, and they've put together a very good plan.
And any successful organisation always starts from the top, and I think Jamie and Tony, they've really brought that Highlanders sort of team culture feeling, and it's really resonated amongst the team, and you're seeing pictures in the changing rooms, and they're a really tight unit, so they'll need that for when this up-and-coming battle is going to happen on
the weekend. It's interesting to consider what the impact of having a team in Super Rugby might have actually had, you know, on the development of some of these players. Do you think, though, that some of Japan's success has come at the expense of supposedly stronger opposition who've underestimated them, and that from this point on, Japan's probably not going to have that advantage?
Well, everyone knows what they can do now.
Yeah.
And there may have been a little surprise element in there, but there was no surprise against Scotland, was there? Scotland knew that they'd already beaten Ireland. They went out, they had to beat Scotland, and they beat Scotland quite convincingly. There's no surprise, and South Africa are probably really, really ready for them, but they beat South Africa last time, so I don't know.
Yeah, 4 years ago was a different sort of kettle of fish, and a very similar situation in Scotland, but I think the South African team will be prepared for this team.
The thing I loved about the Scotland match, though, was, you know, after everything last week with the typhoon and the debate as to whether or not the match was going to go ahead or should go ahead, the rumours then that Scotland were considering legal action if the match didn't go ahead, there was all of this additional pressure on the Japanese team. They came out in that first half and they were completely dominant, and then they came under a sustained period of pressure. A lot of teams without massive big game experience would have folded at that point, but I thought it really spoke to their to their mental strength that they were able to weather that storm from the Scottish and hold on,
and also their physical strength. They're a very fit team, aren't they, as well? He's got them fizzing in terms of their fitness as well. They did hold on and they looked good all the way through.
They have to play that game. They're not a big side, so they have to have quick ruck ball and keep that ball moving these big guys around. And somewhere along those multiple phases, there's going to be an opportunity, and that's been working for them well. So hopefully this game here, again, like we'll talk about a little bit more, if a South African team gets it wrong in the tackle, and because they're big and these guys are lower, and they get it a little bit high, there could be that's the only thing they could get themselves into trouble, bit of car trouble.
Yeah, I think that's that like speaks to every single team in the tournament at the moment. We will get to that very shortly, but let's hear from Kim and Scotty in Japan, who can tell us what having Japan in the quarters has done for the tournament and for the country.
Kia ora, welcome back to Tokyo, the front row crew, Mr. Stevenson and I here to fulfil all of your questions, answers, all of those sorts of things. Oh, I'm losing the plot.
Hopes and dreams.
Hopes and dreams.
We've got your hopes and dreams covered here on the front row.
Tell
today.
You what, speaking of hopes and dreams, segue, hello. This Japan storyline, after they managed to topple Scotland, secure their place in the quarterfinals, first ever World Cup quarterfinal for Japan, down at Yokohama Stadium, absolutely sensational. Mr. Stevenson, you were there. Talk me through the atmosphere.
Kim, I've done a lot of footy, as you well know. I don't think I've ever been in a stadium like that. Right from midday, the fans filled Yokohama, the streets around the stadium. It was just Japanese jerseys everywhere. So festive, and they're such a great friendly bunch as well. The stadium was chock-a-block, as I'm sure you witnessed at home. And after the game, no one left. They were there for an hour at least, just in their seats, or on their feet, should I say, and just soaking up every moment. It was historic in every way. I worked the game with Tamari Allison, and even he, after the game, having spent so much time now in Japan, was very emotional. He saw exactly what that meant to the Japanese people. It was truly an incredible experience for me, a privilege.
And what I loved about it as well is the way it seeped into the kind of ordinary parts of Japanese society. So I watched the game just in a wee bar here in Tokyo. No one particularly seemed like rugby types, so to speak. Certainly there were no red and white jerseys, but there was a TV that was showing the game. And by the end of the night, people were just delirious. There were high fives, there were hugs. I can't remember the last time I hugged so many strangers. It was just a delight.
Do you know, it was. And I believe the television audience here in Japan was something approximately 60 million people. It is the biggest television event this year in Japan for rugby. And all the talk that, oh, it'll never capture the public's imagination, they won't get into the Rugby World Cup, horseshit.
They're dancing on the streets of Shibuya. We saw those scenes. They were sensational. People dancing, streets of Shibuya, the busiest crossing in the world, and there are people just running around in red and white jerseys, and gosh, I just hope that they can go one step further again.
Well, they've got it all in front of them, and I'm glad you got to that point, because we are going to talk about the one game that matters to you folks back home. But also, the South Africa-Japan quarterfinal is going to be a classic game, and I was with the South African press conference guys yesterday, and Dwayne Vermeulen had a great line. He said, "We know what's coming, but we've still got to stop it." They are under no illusions about the threat that Japan poses, even though they absolutely gave Japan a dusting before this tournament started. They are fearful of the style of rugby they're about to face, and Cheslin Kolbe had some very special words about Kingi Fukuoka today, who in that game against Scotland was sensational.
Yeah, Colby's been pretty sensational himself.
That's right.
You talk about that style, and this is interesting, because now we get down to knockout stages, and I suppose you could argue Japan were basically in that situation in the last game anyway, but often you tend to see teams get a little bit more conservative. Do you think that we will see that, A, with Japan?
We will not see it with Japan. I just don't believe it. The strength of Japanese rugby is to play that style of rugby, to accelerate through the tackle line, to get teams into chaotic situations. I don't think they know any other way. South Africa, maybe, will get conservative because they'll want to slow the tempo down, play to their strengths. But no, I think from a Japanese point of view, Kim, we're going to see them all out again with whatever energy they've got left after what was an epic last weekend.
And my same question was also going towards switching gears now. The All Blacks. Do you think that they will start to play a more conservative game now that we're in knockout stage?
It's hard to answer that because, again, I think the strength of the All Blacks is to play with freedom and expression. That's what they like to play, the way they like to play. But, you know, you've been around this team, you've seen their style. Do you think that Ireland have got what it takes to put the sort of pressure on the All Blacks to prevent them playing that way?
I personally don't. No, I think their attack is quite one-dimensional. I do find it intriguing, though, how much you can see with the All Blacks, just that mental switch. Mm. Even being in the press conferences, and all of a sudden, they're in shutdown mode. They are not giving we, the dear people in the media, anything at this point, and we can expect that going forward, but it is a fascinating kind of change in dynamic in how that works.
I can tell you that as soon as Japan got that result over Ireland, the All Blacks have had their mind set on playing Ireland in the quarterfinal. That's what they've planned for. So they've had a lot of time to plan for this game. There was no doubt in their minds that that was the way it was going to finish. That's who they prepared for. And look, it's been going to be 10 days between games for this All Blacks side. It's a long time for a team like that to be sitting back and getting into their work. I don't think their training would have been too brutal this week, but fully focused on the Irish team.
And the Irish, I think, will be quite wary in spite of all the, as you get in the build-up, there's a lot of mind games being played between coaches, sometimes players.
It's a
lot
of a
chat
yawn, isn't it?
No, not at all. We love it. A lot of chat about the history, obviously, because Ireland in recent times has obviously toppled the All Blacks a couple of times. It makes for a fun storyline, certainly. Do you think that from an Irish perspective, they are capable of pulling off what would actually just be a mammoth feat?
Well, they weren't in 2016, they did. They weren't in 2018, they did. And this is a knockout game of rugby, and the All Blacks have exited World Cups at this stage before. I know only once before and some time ago. Like, anything is possible. I think anyone who gets ahead of themselves and starts thinking about semi-finals, finals at the moment, probably just hasn't got a grip with just how close these teams are at the top of the table. There are eight teams left. You could throw a blanket over at least seven of them, and even if you still don't believe in how well Japan are playing, they're there. They are a top eight team. This is do or die rugby, and some teams are set up for that better than others.
Okay, so let's address then the other two quarterfinals that we haven't talked about. First of all, Aussies, England. Aussies not been given much of a chance.
None!
I kind of think it's a mistake.
I do too. Look, they weren't even going to get out of their pool in the last World Cup and they made it all the way to the final. You remember the pre-tournament predictions
in Australia. Do we what?
Look, I caught up with Mike Harris, former Wallaby fly half today, and you know he said, look, they're capable. If they go out there and they play their game, they are capable of beating England. But Eddie Jones has a distinct advantage. He took England down to Australia and dusted them 3-0 in a series. So he knows what he's doing when it comes to playing Australia. Is this team strong enough? Does it have the will to go to war against England? Because it's going to be so attritional.
Oh.
England won't let them do what they want to do. And so, you know, whether they can back it up, I don't know. But you've got to give them a starter's chance. They're there.
And just lastly, and very quickly, Wales, France, what way do you see
no
that going?
No idea.
None of us have any idea.
Issa Nathiwa
warned us a few weeks ago, ahead of this tournament, Issa Nathiwa warned us about France. And he said, everyone is writing them off. Mm. Everyone's saying they won't get out of the pool, that the Argentinians will go through, and yet here they are, and now they are in this stage.
Well, we all remember what happened in 2011 too, don't we, with the semi-final against Wales and the devastation for Sam Warburton after he was red carded in that game. So there's history here.
Mm.
I don't know. The French have been so quiet, and I don't know whether it's just because they've been based in different cities to us, but it's almost like they've gone through this tournament with no one talking about them at all.
Yeah.
I think that's a danger. Wales are a good team, but this is the chance for them to really prove that everything they do well is bedded into their structures. And I think that's what Warren Gatland would have been stressing all week. Don't worry about the French. Do what we do well, and we're every chance of making it through.
Oh, one thing that we think we can guarantee is we're going to see four absolutely cracking games of rugby this weekend. Absolutely cannot wait, team. Thanks for being with us, and we'll leave it back to you now.
Kim and Scotty there in Japan for us. Yes, indeed. We're blessed in this tournament, aren't we, guys? We have four cracking quarterfinals. Let's talk about the All Blacks. Obviously not an ideal situation, missing their final pool play game, heading into these quarterfinals and a tough quarterfinal against Ireland, especially given the fact they haven't really been tested since the very first round of the Rugby World Cup. How do they go about handling that sort of situation, Ofisa?
Well, I think it's because they're sort of simulated game situations in their training leading up to this game, but it's three games of rugby now, and that's all they need to focus on, you know, and this is their first big challenge. I think they've sort of shut shop and everybody's really focused. Traditionally quarterfinals tend to be an easier game, but this one is a test match of epic proportion, so I think it'll hold them in good stead if they're going to progress further on.
What do you think, Paul?
Yeah, I'm a little bit worried that Brodie Retallick hasn't hit any footy.
Yeah.
That's my one big one on that front of not playing that game at the weekend. And
especially given he got through that half an hour, right?
Yes.
He looked good. He came off. You think, well, that's great. If he could have had one more blowout and maybe put on 60 minutes on the park, that would have been great.
But then the guys that are going to come off the bench for him are all in really good form as well. But he is the best player in the world, and they do need him firing. I think I have a sneaking suspicion that Ireland being so successful against the All Blacks in the last few years might count against them in this one. I think the All Blacks will be extra up for this. Yeah. You kind of get that feeling just seeing what's coming back from Japan and just sort of knowing how they like to operate and how they like to think.
I think also that the Italy game was really important to cement those selections because they weren't quite sure, and it would be interesting to see what that team was.
But obviously
it wasn't released, but. So I don't think we'll see any bolters coming into that squad, and it'll be interesting that midfield and what that makeup is.
I'm always intrigued as to how teams in these sorts of tournaments handle the unexpected and indeed use adversity as a motivating factor. Because you know, I agree with you in that the Irish probably aren't as strong as they were a year ago, and the All Blacks will be more cautious. But I also know that inside that Irish camp, they're going to be going, the world's written us off, guys. You know, let's we've got something to prove here. Let's get out there and smash it. the All Blacks as well. You know, there's a perfect opportunity, isn't there, for the coaching staff and the management team to say, guys, you know, this isn't an ideal setup. This is the sort of thing that really tests a champion team when you haven't had a really tough contest in the best part of a month and you're expected to turn up and take on a team that beat you just a short while ago and make your way into the semi-final of a World Cup in a pressure situation. I'm always intrigued as to how teams handle those kind of pressure situations and use adversity as a motivating factor. It's going to be a massive game on Saturday night. We will hear what the coaching staff on both teams expect. First of all, let's listen to Steve Hansen stepping up the mind games in the build-up and a response from Ford's coach for Ireland, Simon Easterby.
Yeah, look, we've got weaknesses like everybody else, so you've got to have a look at your own weaknesses as much as anybody else and say, well, you know that Joe does a lot of study, so that can be a strength and a weakness. Might be able to set him up.
There's no game that you don't go into and try to manipulate the opposition, whether that's setting up in a different way at certain situations in the game, on attack or defence. I've no doubt they'll have something that we haven't seen before and we'll have something that they haven't seen before.
Predictions for the All Blacks match, what do you expect?
I wasn't expecting Simon Easterby's nose to still look like that. That's the first thing. I think it's going to be close. I think the All Blacks will win, but I think it'll be close.
Yeah.
Yeah, again, the third person is going to be really important, Nigel Owen. He's going to play a massive part, but I think that the All Blacks are really information-based and not too emotional, and I think they'll go in there and do a real clinical job of this game.
You mentioned the refereeing, and I think we mention this every week on the front row, but we need to do it again. This incredible policing of tackles around the shoulders and head is becoming a massive talking point in this Rugby World Cup, and again, it's going to influence the quarterfinal. That's a point of concern for me, because you can imagine if an All Black were to be sent off 20 minutes into the game and find themselves 14 against 15
They had a bit of practice on that in Perth.
They have.
They know what to do now.
They have. Well, I mean, they actually had a bit of practice with a man in the bin in the last World Cup final. Mm. But that's the sort of thing that could end up, you know, really counting against them.
And that's what I sort of mentioned probably earlier on, that just to keep an ice cool head going into it. Don't be too emotional, because that you tend to go go and hurt someone rather than make that tackle. Mm. And if you just be quite clinical in what you do, then you're keeping safe.
Okay, we heard Kim and Scotty's predictions for those other quarterfinals. So very quickly, let's work through Wales and France. Ofisa, you were just saying that France haven't had that game yet.
That's right. Yeah. You know, and the quarterfinals, they seem to really fire up. Yeah. And so I think this could be their game and put them back in, because they've been sort of flying under the radar, as everybody knows. So I think I'll give it to... No, I'm going to give it to Wales.
You're going to give it to
Wales? Wales, my daughter was born there, so I'll be cast away if I was to say not Wales. Yeah.
I've got to go Wales too. I think Gats will be too smart. Yeah. Their team will be, just a little bit too good.
You know what I'm concerned about? The English. Yeah. More than anything else in this tournament, the English are my biggest concerns. Talking about flying under the radar, I don't think we've seen anything like a top strength English performance just yet. I feel like they've been holding something back throughout pool play, and I'm just waiting for it.
That first game, Tuolangi came out and showed his power.
Yeah.
He's sort of been nice and quiet, but I think this is his game. He likes to play against the Australians, and this will be a huge game. So I'm sort of picking England by one.
Yeah.
I think I'm picking England just. They did come out and they did smash Australia and Australia. That midfield battle, though, is going to be great. Yeah. Tuolangi and Korobeti, that's going to be awesome. But I just think they're just a little bit too big and a little bit too tough up front for the Aussies.
I'm nervous about England, man. In the latter stages of this tournament, I'm really nervous about them. Finally, then we started with Japan. Let's end with Japan this week. Is there any chance they're going to get up over South Africa, or is this going to be the end of the run?
Oh. There's a chance.
I
think it's a slim chance, but there's a chance. I'd love to see them win again, but I just don't quite see it.
Yeah, my head and my heart are saying two different things, but again, like I mentioned before, someone could get themselves in. And you know how emotional South Africans are going, especially that first 20. You know, if they stay clear of cards, then they'll be all right. But I'm going to go for the underdogs, and hopefully the dream carries
good.
On.
Yeah. Okay, we'll start start penning your notes to get a late start on Monday morning. It's a very exciting weekend ahead. Thank you so much, guys. Really appreciate it. Ofisa Tonu’u and Paul Moore, thank you for watching. Here's to an exciting weekend of quarterfinal action. Go the ABs!